I'm Priyank Pradhan, and I'm the host for the today's webinar. Our webinar topic is Strengthen Security Posture with Azure. This webinar is arranged by the Synergetics Consulting. So before start, I would like to give you a brief introduction of our company. So we are a data center modernization company focusing on transforming the on-premise data centers of our customers to modern hybrid or public cloud-based data center with elasticity, flexibility, and scalable capacity. We achieve this transformation through four key engagements, and these are planning, assessment and discovery, infrastructure solutions deployment and workload migration, application innovation and migration, and the last one is data and AI solutions. With a proven track record of over 25 plus years, we have been transforming our customer infrastructure through based off the breed technology solutions. We help businesses in addressing and solving some critical aspects like HDSPEC, that is high availability, disaster recovery, scalability, performance, economics, and cost rationalization. Next slide, please.
Who has the control? Yeah, next slide, please.
Next slide. Okay, thank you, sir. So coming to the webinar, so our today's webinar topic is Strengthen Security Posture with Azure. As we all know, security is a component of any IT deployment, and the cloud introduces unique security concerns. So making the correct security decisions is critical to the success of your cloud deployments and wider business success. And procedures for addressing threats should be a priority for any IT security or cybersecurity team. I hope this webinar will help you in every possible way, and your feedback is very valuable for us. So we will send you a link of our survey form once the webinar is completed. Next slide, sir.
Manish, yeah, anyone? Yeah.
Yes, thank you. Now I would like to introduce you all to our speaker, Mr. Anand Prabhu, sir. He leads the role of Solution Architect in Synergetics Consulting. He has an experience of 20 plus years in solution architecting and 4 plus years on Azure Cloud Services. My words are less to describe his great work and experience in this industry. So now we will move forward with our webinar, and I would like to invite Mr. Prabhu, sir, to present further. Thank you. Prabhu, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Priyank. Let me just share up. Thanks for the introduction and good afternoon, everyone. I'm trying to present bring up the slide. Just a minute. So is my screen visible, Priyank?
No, sir. Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay. So this is what will be the agenda of this particular webinar, where we'll try to understand the importance of security. And as part of importance of security, the first and foremost, we'll have to understand what is a modern enterprise, what are the challenges faced in this modern enterprise, and the need for Azure governance. Once we understand the need of Azure governance, we'll have to understand what is the governance scaffolding which is being provided by Azure, and as part of the scaffolding, what is a security architecture, how are they proposing a security architecture, a security model, and based on this, there is a tool which is Security Center, which is again every enterprise should have in the best of the breed kind of tool. And the importance of Security Center, where we defined the key features of Security Center of unified visibility, ATP, and intelligent detection and response, and then a tool which helps you do that, Azure Sentinel is what we'll talk about, and at the end we'll define what is that process and how do we keep building on this incrementally on the security process. So that is how the agenda is for the particular seminar.
So
quickly start and get on to, you know, everyone's understanding, you know, this is what an modern infrastructure, a modern enterprise is currently looking at, where cloud, which has become inevitable, people are procuring cloud. There are multiple third-party SaaS applications. There are O365 inside the environment. And then you have your traditional data on-premises data center, the connectivity between the, there is a hybrid connectivity. And you have built a modern data center, which is giving you scalability and elasticity. But with this modern enterprise, what you end up into is a scenario where management is becoming increasingly distributed, where, you know, multiple resources are getting provisioned, multiple applications are getting provisioned, many things are. So the management is shifting between different roles. And as you understand by now, you know, those who have already procured cloud, the way things are getting provisioned and the way environment, it is a more dynamic scenario to manage. So, you know, the traditional approaches won't work to manage such dynamism in your data center. To understand this more in terms of what are the challenges we face is, you know, first and foremost, cloud is bought in by for people who wants elasticity. Based on this, there are roles divided, and based on the roles, every role or a team is defined and given their isolation to work, and that they provide or provision resources. Eventually, what ends at an IT management level is lack of visibility of such resources. So if you are unable to understand how much resources you are going to control and manage, how will you control those? So lack of visibility surely is there. Because of visibility, absence of visibility, there is a lack of control. There is a cost overshoot that is happening because control is not there, or the sizing and the capacity is not being planned. So there is a cost overshoot. Moreover, due to different scenarios where, you know, different departments are provisioning, are they really looking into a scenario where compliance or regulatory compliance is becoming a threat for an organization? Because as part of, example, I'll just give you an example, which is Azure as a cloud. You can create a resource into available 54 data centers. So you just have to select and you say that I created a resource, a virtual machine, a Southeast Asia data center, a India data center, or a New Zealand data center, or a China data center. You can do that. But because of this IT asset that has got created, have anyone made sure that you are not moving as part of, not violating any compliance in terms of regulations? Because if you are part of an RBI defined regulation where, you know, the data should not be outside the country, and you can, in such cases, you cannot provision resources outside India data center. So these are certain challenges. To add this, there are other security risks that are happening. You know, everyone is provisioning resources. So there are multiple endpoints. There are pass endpoints that are there. Then there are VM, every virtual machines by default has a public IP enabled. So the moment we create a virtual machine, there is a public IP that gets created. Now, if you have 100 virtual machines, and if you have not actually changed the default settings, then you will have 100 IP addresses that would have got generated into your subscription. Now, are you monitoring those? Moreover, these have become a threat because this RDP, this IPs, you have said that I need to log in into the virtual machine. I do not have connectivity. That is the reason I have created a public IP. And this is mostly the reasons given. Now, what is the security risk against this? this is opened as a 3389 port is already open. So you have multiple ports open, port 80 open, port 443. Fine, these are two things. But then what happens to your DDoS attacks or denial of DDoS attacks or your malware or scenario that gets into and creeps into such vulnerable service endpoints. So these are the challenges which are we are facing in the current scenario, and to monitor, take control of these challenges, or to you have to have a structured scenario, and that is the reason why Azure came up with a governance, saying that you should be adopting as per the cloud adoption framework. And under cloud adoption framework, they have defined a governance as a area which IT operations people should understand. Now, this is one of that Azure scaffolding, which is well described and documented as part of governance under cloud adoption framework. So this is Azure scaffolding for you. And if you really look into how your resources are, so this particular scenario, every resource that you create, does it have a resource tag? Is there a proper naming convention defined as for a resource group? Are you taking care of, are your resources being logged? Is there any kind of automation that is happening? Are you following the naming standards? Is this covered under security center? Or is this visible under security center? So this is the entire scaffolding which CAF, as in cloud adoption framework, has defined under governance. So this is where this becomes a foundation to follow. Based on this, they have come. Microsoft had described, saying that this is the governance architecture one an organization should follow. And this, and keep building on this governance architecture. Now, what they say is, stop using the earlier classic resources which has been created, and get onto the new structure, which is the ARM. Because based on the ARM structures, there is a policy engine which can use to govern ARM built resources, and this policy engine actually helps you monitor your subscriptions, your management groups by doing policy definitions. You can have your role-based access, and then you can define those ARM templates to deploy your resources. As part of the governance architecture, there are three ways things can be provisioned, either through an Azure portal or through a PowerShell or a CLI or any third-party tool. So that is how things are being provisioned. As part of your resources, there is Azure Resource Graph, wherein you can query on what resource, and depending upon that, you get relevant information. And in terms of a scenario where you will have to define certain blueprints, so that you have resource consistency across your Azure subscription. So that is how the entire governance architecture is all about. And through ARM, obviously, then you can create your virtual machines, your different storage, your networks, and other resource providers. All are based now as part of your ARM structure, resource manager structure. So all these come under ARM. So that's basically your governance architecture. Now, when you spoke about the governance architecture, let's understand, and get into the heart of understanding, how important security is, and let's understand the security landscape. So to start with, you have a scenario where you have on-premises devices, on-premise resources, and cloud resources. Now, we can't say that, cloud can be monitored differently, on-premises can be monitored differently. This is an entire scenario which one has to cater to as part of the IT landscape. And things are the way things are happening on premises is getting increasingly complex. And on the cloud side, you have evolving threats. So this is how things are. So you have rising costs everywhere, and then there is a skill set which is of, you know, what is not available in abundance. So there is a talent gap, you know, and this is where, you know, you should have tools to close such gaps. And that is the reason, you know, we are trying to come up with a scenario that let's understand how do you build your security posture with Azure so that you cut down all your maintenance overheads and start following the posture so that, you know, it is less vulnerable and you can mitigate most of your risk. So let's understand what is the security model and how this is being built upon. So first and foremost, is there is a foundation. So you should have a secure foundation where, you know, Microsoft provides you that secure foundation, right, with media, and gives you infrastructure at a very less cost. So if you are building a traditional infrastructure, you know what are the costs involved, you know, the real estate cost, the ancillary devices cost, the UPS cost, all this is taken care of by Microsoft. And that is where they say they have built a secure data center already. Then there is one has to understand the unique intelligence through detection of new threats, and we should be able to respond rapidly. And then as part of security controls, what are built-in controls which an organization can leverage, saying that, okay, this is readily available, can I use this? And that's how, you know, you start saving cost by using just and configuring the built-in controls. So let's understand what are these controls. So more into these three components in terms of building your security posture. First and foremost, the secure foundation. Now, this particular foundation is already provided by Microsoft, that is by Azure. And the physical data centers are governed, the Azure infrastructure and the operational security of these data centers, all of this is governed by Microsoft. And based on this governance, and it provides you the SLA of your services, that is your service level agreements. So this is the initial foundation which is already being there as part of Microsoft services, which is included in the cost when you provision a resource on Azure. So let's understand what is available as part of built-in controls. So as a part of built-in controls, we have identity and access management. We have data protection. There is a network security. Then we have tools for advanced threat protection. And we have a tool which can manage things from a center, and which is called as security center or security management. Finally, the unique intelligence which is being provided through other services. Now the services which are used are machine learning, threat intelligence, and behavioral analytics. And there is a tool by the name Sentinel, which is being used, you know, which one can leverage to get this intelligence and behavioral analytics through the activities that are getting, the incidents that are being raised, or the activities that are being actually logged, and based on that, the intelligence gets provided. So this is that unique intelligence service, which is Azure Sentinel. I'll speak more about this in the later slides. So first and foremost, let's understand the scenarios in terms of the built-in controls. So the first and foremost is, you know, if you want to cover any access control currently, that is the reason you have on-premise AD, Active Directory, there. So that is your identity solution. So any user control or access control, you will have to manage through your user identity and define an access control based on that. Now there is a tool, there is an on-premise directory, and then there is Azure Active Directory Connect as a tool which syncs up with your Azure AD, and then Azure AD becomes an a scenario for supporting your applications for single sign-on. Now, as part of Azure Active Directory, there are different plans of Azure Active Directory based on which there are certain features which you can actually leverage. Most of them are, principle of least privilege. That is, you can understand the role-based access control and Azure Active Directory conditional access-based policies. Now, this is what you get as part of your base Azure AD. Then you have additional identity protection through MFA, multi-factor authentication. Now, this is where there is a different plan inside Azure AD, which can be opted for, and this is chargeable. And this is where, you can strengthen your identity security. Now, Azure AD also gives you certain monitoring and capabilities and control privileged accounts. So through their PIM solutions, and it you can also enable threat protection with your Azure AD identity protection. So there are additional plans for this. So the plans are available in the public domain. But this is using Azure AD, you can start defining your perimeter security and the access control, and that's how you start moving towards building your security foundations. The next part of is in terms of your data and how is data being protected. So Azure has a key vault, Azure Key Vault, where you can store your keys and you can start doing encryptions. So Azure Storage, there is a service, Azure Storage has inbuilt encryptions, and the encryption keys can be stored in Azure Key Vault. Then you, Azure allows you to have disk encryptions, and for your SQL databases, you can have the SQL TD and always encrypted scenario for your SQL databases. And for your endpoints, Azure has, you can configure firewalls with, there are at pass services. For example, you have Azure SQL database firewalls where you can restrict the access of the database through certain IPs and certain networks. Then you have Azure Storage Firewall. You have your host and virtual network appliance based firewalls. So this is how there are different SKUs that which can help you build your security against your resources. Then you have shared access signature enables more granular access controls for your storage account. So if you are using a storage accounts, then your storage objects can be accessed, and then there is a key mechanism which can help you control it granularly. And finally, the key management system, which is your Azure Key Vault. So this is what do you call keys in a hardware HSM. You need not have to store them in some other known location. And then there is a best practice where he says that use one key per security boundary or per region or per app, because that helps you in terms of the key being less circulated in terms of for those who want to access them. And then use key vaults to enroll and automatically renew certificates. Now look into a scenario where you have a number of websites. For example, if you have a pharma, if you're part of a pharma enterprise, and then you have a scenario where each of your product is having a website. Now this website can all get consolidated behind a particular firewall. So that's the kind of best practices one can implement. So you have 25 odd websites, all of them having one single web application firewall. You can provision an application gateway and build a proper enable a WAF based on that application gateway, and then isolate the access only through one particular service endpoint. And now all your things, all your websites are protected, they are consolidated. And then for your SSL, you can use Azure Key Vault. So your key management and certificate management becomes very easy. So this is what is there in terms of protection for you. And this also helps in more in terms of, you know, managing, controlling your risk. You can now have one single VAPT across all your websites, and you start saving costs. So this is one of the scenario how, in terms of, you know, you can secure your virtual machines or applications and storage and databases through, you know, a security like firewalls, as well as key management through Azure Key Vault. Now, as part of network access controls, there are scenarios where you have the NACs to control your, which provides you basic access control over your network. You can do an inbound and outbound rules you can define on the NACs. Now, these NACs can be applied onto your NIC or onto your subnet or onto your VNet. Then you have connectivity tools like VPN. So one use a dedicated connection to the data center, so you can secure that and all your data center data center communication happen through a VPN. If you require a more secure and a dedicated pipe, then you can opt for Azure Express Route, which works over an MPLS backbone, and which is a dedicated pipe and it is not exposed to the internet. So this is how you can strengthen your network connectivity. And in terms of applications, as I said, you can use application gateways and application firewalls. And on the VNet side, you can configure a standard DDoS protections. So this is how you can do and control your networks. And in terms of, you know, advanced threat protection, what you can do is mitigate potential vulnerabilities proactively by ensuring up-to-date VMs with relevant security patches. Now, how do you know, you know, how many VMs are properly patched or not patched? You know, you'll have to hold your fort. I'll explain that as part of a security center where, you know, visibility is more of essence. So I'll try to speak more on that in the further side. But, you know, this is how you protect your workloads. You reduce your surface area of attack by creating just-in-time access to management ports. So what you'll have to do is you'll have to allocate certain management ports and keep them open. I'll give you an instance why this is happening, or, you know, configure application whitelisting to prevent malware execution. So I'll tell you how you can use just in time, and I'll tell you why this has been used most of the places. You know, just in time is blocked, saying that it is being regulated. But look into a scenario. I just have one of my customer who got a ransomware attack, and because of that, you know, they ended up where their entire ED machine went down, their backup went down, and the Azure infrastructure, they cannot be logged into the Azure infrastructures because there was a scenario where it was tightly integrated with Azure AD. When such things happen, then, you know, you should have your just-in-time access to your management ports, and you can help get into your network at least. But with the kind of COVID-19 scenario, there are more such attacks that are happening. So and IT staff should be a little more cautious. The last 3 days, I have heard at least 6 other instances where there were ransomware attack has happened. So now you know that, you know, you can reduce your surface area of attack. You will also have to build a system where, you know, you can detect your threats early and respond faster. So you should be able to understand this Yeah, you know, whether I am able to, or whether, you know, there are symptoms of me getting attacked, or, you know, you have defined actionable alerts and incidents. So if you have enabled DDoS on your network and you are monitoring using network watcher, then all these alerts, you can configure alerts for certain what you call parameters being, you know, overshooted. If that happens, then such alerts will help you mitigate your risk and detect your threats earlier. Then there are interactive investigation tools and playbooks to orchestrate your responses. So this is more in terms of, you know, Azure Sentinel, what we are talking about, which can help you orchestrate certain responses by a use of logic apps integrated tightly with the activity log. So how are we enabling visibility and control access across hybrid workloads? So you should have a centralized view of your digital state, and you have a centralized view of security state across all your on-premises as well as your cloud resources. So you should be able to configure certain agents for Azure resources. And then you can deploy agent to onboard hybrid workloads as well. So that you start getting those informations into a centralized repository, and you can monitor all such resources, and you can control access through those monitoring scenarios. Then eventually you will have to integrate auditing, logging, and existing processes. So what you'll have to do is, though, as you are aware that all the resources which get which are provisioned on Azure, they generate an activity log. So if you have an on-premise SIEM tool, what you can do is configure Azure activity log to send data to Event Hub, and eventually the Event Hub sends data to your local SIEM. Or else, you know, you can use an SIEM tool, or more than an SIEM, something like Azure Sentinel. In terms of auditing and logging every resource, you can enable a diagnostic log that helps you in troubleshooting. And this data gets accumulated as part of your log and analytics eventually for advanced analysis. So every time you provision a resource, let's put in a practice that, you know, you enable a diagnostic log, so troubleshooting and analysis become easy. And for activity log, make sure that you have a seam where you are monitoring the same. If not, then, you know, you can have and configure it to your on-premise seam where the data gets captured as part of the Azure resource activities. Furthermore, you know, if you are thinking only in terms of Azure related resources, then Security Center becomes one of the important tools, because all this, based on this log analytics, Security Center itself gives you a majority of scenarios and tells you more in terms of your vulnerabilities and gives you a security count for, you know, your resources. We'll speak more on this. Based on, you know, how do we implement a Security Center so that, you know, you have, as part of a trusted platform, you say that you have security, privacy, and control. You should monitor there should be a transparency, and then you should be monitoring compliance. Security Center comes to your rescue here. Through Security Centers, you can monitor your compliance. In terms of, you just have to enable what compliance you are adhering to, whether they are CIS controls or, you know, HIPAA related compliance. For that, you just go and enable your policy accordingly, and the policy violations get monitored as part of Security Center. And under Security Center, you start getting this inputs of, you know, what is your secure score and out, and how many VMs are vulnerable for certain attacks. Security center also gives you, you know, in terms of, you know, what is your usage trends, and it gives you certain advisory reports. This becomes a more like a scenario where through intelligence, intelligently identifying your vulnerabilities as well as your cost overruns, it has a unified scenario where it gives you everything onto one single dashboard. Now let's understand what is security center. First and foremost, security center helps you gain visibility and control, right? And you just not have to do much of a thing, because you know most of the things are, and once you have enabled the standard controls, security center is already in play, and it gives you security at the speed, in the speed which wherein you know you provision your resources. Now look into a scenario that you had an on-premise resource provisioning, and what is that you will have to do to enable security on that provisioning. Here with Microsoft Azure Security Center, you don't have to do anything because you have already enabled Security Center at a subscription level, and if keep monitoring your resources. And it also gives you vulnerabilities so that you can keep up with your cyber threats. Now this becomes very important for you. Before I start defining security, let's understand a little security responsibilities. Right, so there is a cloud workload owner who manages a cloud workload and his related resources. So he is a guy of, you know, a DevOps role. Now Ellen is responsible as a CISO and a CIO. So he is responsible for all aspects of security for the company. Then there is an IT security guy, David. Then there is security ops person and the security analyst person. Now, if you really look into security center at a CIO and a CISO level, there has to be a uniform dashboard to this person, which tells them, you know, how compliant the organization IT resources are. And then, you know, what is the security score for his organization? Security center helps you give this score to the person. As part of IT security, if there are certain vulnerabilities, then these vulnerabilities are pointed out, saying that, you know, so many machines have public IPs. Do you really need that? Now, all this happens. Why is that not behind a WAF? All these questions are asked by. Just hold on. Hello. Yeah, wait. Hello. There's a disturbance at my end. Just hold on for a minute. I'll be back. Yeah, sorry about this. What we can do is you can give me a 5 minutes break. I can request for a 5 minutes break, and I can again continue from this slide so that we can proceed further. So I'll be back by around, say, another 5 minutes. In 5 minutes. So I'll join the session at 15:25. Okay, so I'm back. So before I resume, are there any questions till on any of the topics till now? So I'll wait and answer those questions, and then if there are any inputs, you can speak out. So are there any questions till now? Hello?
No, actually.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? So any challenges being faced currently, which we can address currently as when we are describing and the usage of Azure Security Center, if there are any things which we can address, or are such questions available to you now? Okay, perfect. So I'll start moving ahead. You can stop me in terms of, you know, if I have a question in between, and then we can take it there, or else at the end of that topic, I'll still go ahead and answer that question. So now moving to our understanding of why Security Center, because it helps you gain enable security at a rapid pace, and keeps you informed regarding the other side, regarding the cyber threats. Now there are different people, and then each individual role has its own scenario to manage, and based on that, security gives you management scenarios for all these roles and visibility to all these roles based on their roles. There is a score defined at a organization level for IT security. It tells or the vulnerability score. At the operations level, it helps you monitor things and response to your security alerts. And at a security analyst level, it gives you and investigates attacks. So that is how the core capability of Azure Security Center is. So the first and foremost is it gives a unified visibility and control. So through Security Center, you can actually understand how many resources you have been provisioned. Out of these resources, how many are having a security vulnerability, and based on that, you know, what is how you can mitigate those things. So Security Center consists of three components: the visibility and control scenario, adaptive threat prevention, and intelligent detection and risk. So let's before that, you know, let's understand the security architecture. So what Security Center looks into, what is the repository a Security Center is into? So first and foremost, whether you have a cloud cloud data center, as well as in Azure data center, as well as your on-premise data center, both of this can push logs into the log analytics. Now log analytics and security analytics, both of these actually form a repository for your Azure Security Center. So this is basically a Security Center architecture. Based on this, you can there is an API which is being provided, and then there is an automation which is available, so that you know you can send the notification on on certain parameters which are under observations. So you can configure those, and you can then define actionable recommendations also through your logic apps. So this is where the entire security architecture is. Now also remember that at places where you have a scenario where you collect all your syslogs or other events, all this can be pushed onto log analytics. Now not necessary that know, you can do this only for your Azure related resources, but you can do this for your on-premises resources also. So now if you look into the visibility scenario, this is how the dashboards will look like for you. If you see on the dashboard, you have your recommendations, and it says that I have 24 total recommendations for you. And first and foremost, you know, how easy it is to configure it, just enable where you say, you know, we need the security center enabled, and there is no other thing that is required. The discovery is automatic of all the Azure resources. And you know, you can also gain insights for other hybrid resources, whether on-premise or any other cloud you have been using. All of these can send data to log analytics, and that can actually, you know, create that data can then be given a visualization through your security center. The consolidation happens at the security center level. Now, if you really look into it, is giving you a scenario where it is showing you at an overview scenario where it is recommendations are given. Then there are security solutions. How good are you in terms of your security? How many alerts? How many incidents? And what are the different events that have happened and that has been collected by security center? So this is an overview count for you. Then in terms of preventions, how can you prevent certain vulnerability in terms of compute? Now, if you keep on compute, then it will get into telling you, you know, how many public IPs are there? Are your disk encrypted? Now, all this, you can, you know, write policies for this and enable those policies, and the score gets accumulated as part of your security center. So this gives you the visibility of your resources. If you look into the detection part, where it gives you, you know, a certain security alert, how many of them were the high severity alerts, then it is giving a graph in terms of severity of alerts. And if you look into the right side, it is telling you how many resources are being attacked and which are the most attacked resources. So this gives you understanding in terms of, you know, how your posture is in terms of security. So this is a vulnerability report for, I said, for a virtual machine, and it says that, you know, certain things are open for you. You do not have an endpoint protection installed, and it is highlighting that. Then the system updates are missing. You know, disk encryptions are missing. OS versions are not updated, and it gives you all such vulnerabilities. Now, this actually helps you a lot in terms of giving you insight at one single place. If you remember, it is telling that you have a classic resource. Now change this to a web resource. And what, how it has to be changed, it is giving you recommendations as well. Now this can be for every resources that get provisioned on Azure. So ideally you should go and enable security center, the standard one. Now, to as part of Azure governance, you define compliance. So, have you know, any one of you who has defined any policies on their Azure resources? Can I have a discussion on this? Yeah, anyone? Any one of you have added a policy? No one? Surprise. Yeah, I'm waiting for questions or a revert from your side. Okay, none. So now, in terms of compliance, if your organization is having any regulatory compliance, so what you can do is define a policy scenario, a compliance policy scenario through Azure Security Center, where you can monitor the compliance, and it will tell you, you know, that once you have configured a security policy for a subscription level, or for that matter, multiple subscriptions using Azure Management Groups, then you know you can have a unified view of those policy adherence dashboards of this, how many of them have got adhered to. So even that score gets defined as part of your policy management. So this is defining more of a policy. So this is security policies for subscription and resource group. Now, anyone who has more than 100 resources on Azure, right? How many of you have actually gone and provisioned a lock on that resources, or that for that matter, what if you know you have resources that are part of your resource group, right? And normally we have a habit of you know creating a resource group based on a workload name. So all your workload related resources are part of the same resource group. So if that is a practice, have you made sure that your resource group is being locked? Otherwise, it can get deleted and your entire workload can get deleted. So in such case, is there a policy being defined saying that secure your resource group or protect your resource group? Have you written anyone written such or enabled such policies on their subscription? Okay, we're not getting any revert. Okay, I'll move further. Okay, so now you can get deeper insights with integrated log analytics. Now that you have got to know that most of your and all of your events that get captured as part of Azure, they go and get deposited as part of log analytics. Now, log analytics, you can you know actually query those and have certain you know what you are called customized workspaces which you can leverage to have a visual you know representation of that data. So Logsearch is one of such representation where you can use actually, or you can build in a custom queries and search your do a search on the log analytics, and it will give you. So this is where you can do that search across your security events, or you can you have a visual representation by using one of the erstwhile OMS is what it was called as. Today is integrated as log analytics. So you can have those workspaces enabled for you to gain certain, you know, more visibility, graphical visibility into your analytics, or, you know, your graphical visibility of your logs. Moreover, you know, now that the data is at a centralized location, you can have and use Power BI. You can configure Power BI to get into understanding your security center or you know your logs that have got generated as part of your Azure subscriptions, then you can have a view to these logs through Power BI, or you can even build your own views. So what does it give is Azure Security Center is giving you a near real time alert as if it is an SIEM tool. So if you have a resource provision, and if you have Azure diagnostic enabled into an Azure storage, even that can be pushed into Azure log integration, and you can have a visibility of that through Azure Security Center. So if anyone has enabled a DDoS protection on the network, the DDoS, if the standard plan is enabled, so the DDoS scenario puts in another DDoS SKU puts data into is diagnosed. You just have to enable a diagnostic log for DDoS, and based on those diagnostic log, you start getting alerts. Now all this visibility you can get through your security center. Now, if you are, as I told you, that there are different responsibilities as part of a security. Now you can prioritize those, and if you have a SQL related workload, then you want to understand how are you against the score for a SQL workload. Then you can have and define a priorities based on such security logs being gathered. So this is one of those screenshots where, you know, it gives you a scenario how many of your databases have TDE enabled. That is the highlight, and it says for this database, TDE is not enabled. And now it is showing a vulnerability and telling that, you know, TDE protects your data and helps meet compliance requirement by encrypting databases, right? So this is how it gives you recommendations. And from here only you can do a data encryption on, and it gets automatically enabled for that particular resource. So it also helps in navigation and quick management of the security vulnerability or security threats. Right, so this is a great tool to have once you know you are onboarded on Azure. I'll suggest every one of you to actually enable Security Center, the standard part. Now, you can analyze security information from variety of services that you can have vindicated partners. So you have firewalls and anti-malware solutions, and they can push into a log. Data into log analytics. You can monitor your Azure Active Directory in information protection. You can define, you know, also have visibility of your AT advanced threat analytics. You can do through security centers. Security solution, but mind you that it only CEF formats are you know allowed to push into log analytics. If they are not adhering to that, then you won't have visibility of such data. So your data that gets into log analytics should be of common event format, that is CEF format. So there are different partner solutions that are available. Now your likes of network virtual appliances like your Cisco, the Barracudas of the world, the Fortinet, Checkpoint, the Cloudflare, all these solutions you can actually pull data from here and push it into log analytics, wherein security center can give you insights on those data as well. So let's move on to the next particular component, which is adaptive threat prevention. So how does security center helps you do that? So it continuously analyzes data from, you know, various virtual machines or your services that you provision onto services like storage accounts, your SQL databases, or your PostgreSQL databases, or any other patch databases. Then the network part of, and how many networks, your express route, your network watchers, your VPN tunnels, and it keeps continuously analysis, does analyze all the logs that are generated by these resources. And it has an intelligent machine learning tool behind itself which is again a great tool which it leverages to provide you intelligence and more advanced analytics so that you know you can detect threats, right? And it defines you certain security alerts and it can help you prioritize those alerts. Now these alerts can be insights of into attack. Almost many of the times this can be also alerts can be of recommendations of how do you remediate your risk. So now if you really look into this particular scenario, it is telling us if there is an scenario that is under detection, is there something, things that has been detected. So yes, this is a detection that has arrived and it is giving you more details. So that is how it is helping you, and then it will help you to steps to even remediate the vulnerability or the risk. So one more such incident which has been detected. And if you see that there are remediation steps which are being highlighted, saying that escalate the alert to an information security team or review the remediation step of each one of the alerts. And internal alerts also have their own remediations that are available. So these kinds of alerts are possible through security centers. So as a part whole in terms of threat prevention, what it does is it gives you a threat intelligence. It is giving you behavioral analytics. It is giving you anomaly detection. And it gives you, combined events, like, if there are any SQL injections and Azure SQL logs, or there are if there is a malicious process that has happened or the breach detection that has happened, it will give you all those alerts. It helps you identify and remediate vulnerabilities quickly, and it tells you how your security health is, how good are you in terms of how secure are you in terms of the security or compliance in your among your IT resources. Now remember, there is a continuous updates of different additional security items or recommendation coming in. Every time there is a different list, and it continuously keeps building on the list, so that you are actually being alerted, and it keeps continuously telling you your vulnerability score, so that you can pull that score down or increase your score in terms of score in terms of your security as well as your security posture. So now in terms of brute force attacks, what is how does it help you limit exposure? So this is that scenario wherein saying that you should activate just in time VM access, right? And it gives you how many of the just in time VM accesses are not being done, and it will tell you through the same scene highlighted VM, you can go and click on details and then fix that by just enabling the just in time access. So now in terms of your malware and other unwanted applications, so you can have your application controls where you can have a scenario where it defines your whitelisting rules for your application, saying that this is a known scenario and please whitelist it, so that anything beyond this can be alerted and you have that visibility saying that, okay, or the notification saying that, you know, this has been identified or the incident has been identified. So it allows you also to whitelist so that false alarms are not being raised. And finally, in terms of intelligent detection and response, how does Security Center help you there? It gives you threat intelligence, as I said, and anomaly detection, which was already stated during our earlier slide. Now, the base of this is Intelligent Security Graph. So Intelligent Security Graph helps you help Security Center build on this advanced analytics. And then, you know, it detects threat across the chain. For example, you know, the chain as it goes, it target an attack, install an exploit, and post breach, what we'll have to do. So during target and attack, that is inbound brute force, RDP and SHS, SQL attacks are more. That's what it says. So for that, how do you handle that? So it identifies in-memory malware and exploit attempts, suspicious process executions, and certain breach in terms of you know, your resources being compromised due to an outbound code scanning or brute force that is happening. So it detects all such threat across the chain. And based on this, it gives you critical alerts and prioritize such alerts. Now this is that dashboard across your kill chain. So what it is doing is, if there is are multiple alerts, then it consolidates all those and provides you a single incident saying that all this has been identified and this is an incident we are suspecting is happening. And it, you know, against that incident, it gives you your recommendation. So insights in more of, you know, it tells you where the attack is happening from with an interactive map. And it gives you very, you know, multiple threat reports in terms of the known objectives, tactics, and techniques. So many a times whenever there are certain attacks, there is an intent and this is being already observed at multiple customers or those learnings are being passed on to other customers, which helps you tell what are the tactics, what does this particular attack does, and what are the techniques used by an attacker, and accordingly it suggests you certain remediation as part of this era. That is now for all such reasons, Security Center stands out to be, you know, one of the great tools Azure has, so that, you know, most of your things get remediated, most of your risk gets remediated, first get highlighted, and then you can very easily remediate and, you know, increase your health score. Now in terms of operations, you know, it is helping you simplify your security operations and investigations. So very small window to look into, you need not have. So this is getting more and more built with it so that you can respond quickly to your threats. You can have, you know, built common workflows, right? Create playbooks with integration of Azure Logic Apps and all this. So this workflows which you build, you can define a route to a ticketing system. You can gather additional information, or based on this alert, you can apply additional security controls, or you can validate an action, or based on this particular threat, you can go and block a suspicious user account. So if, you know, with the current COVID-19 scenario, this will help you to understand a ransomware attack as well. So rather than we being part of a scenario where we have gotten a ransomware attack, if you will have a security center, most of this suspicious activities can be tracked. Your anyone who is doing a network browse can be tagged, you know, tapped, and you know, suddenly it gives you this account as a threat, saying that this account is doing a network scan or something. Please change, and accordingly, if you can change, you can stop a ransomware attack. And finally, in terms of, you know, intelligent detection and response, what they Azure gives you is a wonderful tool which is called as Azure Sentinel. It helps you detect threats and build activity on cases where, you know, activities like related alerts, they are gathered together as we spoke. You can investigate on those alerts. You can build a case management scenario based on that. And then eventually you can respond to the threat either manually, or you can play, do a or configure a playbook through a logic app saying that, okay, when this happens, plus first do this. Now, anything for a ransomware attack, whatever you can do is, you know, if anyone who is doing a network scan and you're so you can write a rule in Sentinel so that it can go and block that user account. And then you can build a case and understand, you know, and investigate whether it is really a SIN, or if it is, then, you know, further go ahead and change the identity. Or if it is not, then it's easy to unblock the account. But then, you know, by changing a password, so you can have you can actually provide such ransomware attacks getting onto if you are known to certain you know, threats that are happening on your IT infrastructures. So finally, in terms of information protection, you can do a policy setting, right? And you can do policy enforcement, because that will help you protect your data. And you can have an integration with Azure Information Protection. So all this, including all this, what you can build using Azure Security Center. And finally, in terms of the process, so before I explain you the process, which is will take another 5 minutes, are there any questions till now on Security Center? Okay, so I'll go ahead in terms of when we are speaking about a modern enterprise, right, it should be resilient to threat. And in a modern data center, which is normally aligned to a business objective, and is rigid in terms of the resilient under the current threat environment. And to this, identity is your best tool to first control your security perimeter and protect identity systems. So that is your one thing which you will have to always look into in terms of your identity solution. And that's one of the thing which I wanted to highlight as part of this particular session, that please use Azure AD and configure your local on-premise AD to connect with Azure AD to get this benefits out of identity. And finally, in terms of governance, where we have explained you the governance architecture when you start your journey through cloud, you built in you follow the governance model or the governance scaffolding defined by cloud adoption framework of Azure. As part of governance, you start very small. That is where it says that minimum viable product, which is which can be built. And now this is also termed as your landing zone. And as part of a landing zone, you can define your baseline identity security baseline And as part of a security baseline, we will recommend that you enable your policy management as well as security center, so that you know you start controlling, securing your IT infrastructure. Now that will be a good start to you, and then incrementally you can keep implementing policies, and these policies can then get evolved over a period of time based on your corporate policies as well as other governance policies. So this is where you actually can start small with a minimal viable product, and as part of minimal viable product, we suggest that you actually enable security center with the standard SKU of security center. And if your infrastructure is more than 50 odd machines, then we will suggest that you also enable DDoS on the network which is hosting those virtual machines. So that's how you can start having an incremental governance as a process. So I am at the end of the session. I have covered mostly in terms of how you can build your security posturing. So are there any questions further so that I can answer as part of this session? Yeah, any questions? Okay, I'll wait for a minute, and Neetu, you can take over from here.
Okay, sir.
Okay, Neetu.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot, everyone. Yeah, Neetu, go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for your informative session, sir, as always. I would require 5 minutes to just wind up this session. As next step for these webinars, next steps, so we would be, our team would be sending out couple of survey forms to you regarding the security posturing on Azure. So I would request every one of them who would receive it, please fill out the forms also. So once you fill out the form, there would be based on the survey forms, we would be providing you with executive briefs or some cloud assessments on the security and the cost management factors on the Azure environment. So for more details, our team would be reaching out to you after the call ends. So thank you, everyone, for joining. So Priyank, if you would like to conclude the call. Hello, Priyank. Okay, I think he is not available on the call. So thank you, everyone. So see you again on our next upcoming webinars like this. Thanks for your support. Thanks for joining.
Thanks, everyone.